With a key, you unlock a door to imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sight. A dimension of sound. A dimension of mind. You're moving through a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. Guiding you through this wondrous journey is the hypnotic sound of the twilight zone.
What's up with everybody out there in the Raider Nation? It is Raider Fan Radio in your face, doing what we do. Raider Rob, the beautiful black hole Steph, and of course Mr. Stoner, do the high one. Yes, yes, yes. Here in Vegas for you on another silver and black show for you. Show number 13. But not unlucky. Wow. Not unlucky.
They said it would never happen. They said it wouldn't last. But here we are.
Show number 13. Who are they?
Yeah, who are they?
Who are they?
They are the ones that are subscribing and liking and commenting right here at RaiderFan Radio on YouTube.
Right.
And we love having you. Thanks for coming back again.
Yes, of
course.
You
know, last week, last show number 12, was our big Christmas special. It was a huge extravaganza. Fans from all around the world were digging on it. We had a great time doing it. I noticed we had around 7,000 views, a little bit more. As a matter of fact, there was even a few comments that went along with it. Because you can comment right here on YouTube, Raider Fan Radio. Like, comment, subscribe. We love your subscriptions.
And we hope you all had a good Christmas, too. All of you out there in the Raider Nation land had a good Christmas, got what you wanted. Santa's ass showed up. And maybe even Satan. with a bag of people.
You know, Raider Man contacted us on our comments
Raider
right
Man.
Here. Now, last week, last show,
Raider
you made a comment, Raider Rob, how we weren't up on our Christmas porn. But Raider Man said, no shit, Rob. Apparently nobody's watching Christmas porn but us. Because you know damn effing well I'm all over Christmas porn.
Oh, is he all over it?
Apparently Raider Man's all over Christmas porn.
Their protection.
I've had a chance to do a little research over the holiday myself just to make sure.
Oh, yeah.
Raider Art said, happy birthday, Raider Black Hole Seth.
Raider Art.
And shout out to Shieldhead, who was on the show. We were very stoked to have our famous, awesome friend, Shieldhead, we've known for so many years. Sugar White Mike, who was a great caller last week, said, happy Kwanzaa to Rob and Steph, but not to me, apparently.
Right.
Because Kwanzaa lives matter.
So,
happy Kwanzaa to you too, Sugar White.
Hello to you too.
Down there in Miami, man, doing his thing. Yeah, thank you for all the comments, Kwanzaa Live.
Right.
And then you with the Kwanzaa Bunny. What the fuck?
Hey. What
the hell is a Kwanzaa Bunny?
I don't know. I just figured I'd put them all together.
You know? Whatever.
I would just stick all my fictitious icons together.
We have to keep our eye out and see if anybody appropriates that one, Stone. So,
right, the Kwanzaa Bunny.
Now, I'll draw them up. I'll draw it for the next show.
Oh, cool.
Now, this is our last show of 2020, the evil, dreaded 2020 that we've all been saying, I wish this year would end.
Oh, man.
I don't know what you're expecting next year any different, but yes, 2020 is over. And I was going to do my real quick, lightning fast year in review.
Oh, lightning fast.
Are you ready for this? It sucked! That's my year in review.
Was it fugly?
It was fugly. It sucked. It was sugly. It was all that put together. Yes, I would like to get this over with and end it and keep moving on. Hopefully.
I didn't know any better when I was a kid in the 70s growing up, but there seemed like there were times I remember the lines for the gas. in the late, early and mid-70s as a kid, the OPEC oil crisis, and it seemed the world was coming to an end then. You know, and everybody, I didn't understand too much what the adults were talking about, but it just seemed all of that, and Watergate, and that, so that was another time I remember where it seemed like the world was coming to an end, or it just seemed that the years were bad, 73, 74, 75, doom and gloom.
They were actually cool.
You know, then I was having a great time as a kid in the 70s.
And in the 80s.
It just sucks for the grown-ups.
And then in the 80s, after Reagan and Reaganomics and all that, when I got to the tail end of the 80s, speaking of having a good time, there was all this, you know, revisionist history about how bad the 80s had been, and I had a fucking wonderful time in the 80s. So I looked back and was like, what was so bad about the 80s? I mean, yeah, crack, and, you know.
Yeah, crack.
They took arts and culture out of schools, and there was a whole bunch of bullshit that happened. Of course, ketchup. Ketchup was deemed a vegetable, you know, and all that. But even then, in the 90s, and, you know, Iraq War, blah, 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 9/11 starting off 2000s, and
they got something for us
century.
Every decade, don't
but,
they?
But you know what? There's a big difference, though.
This one was fucked up.
Yeah, this one's fucked up because when it comes to the kids, and it's always about the children, and we do care about the children. About the children.
I do, too.
Because I had a great childhood. And I see a lot of the kids nowadays, I mean, they can't go outside. I mean, you're right.
Can't go to school.
The grown-ups were worried about all the major, you know, headaches and things that they had to deal with in the gloom and doom.
Right.
But as a kid, at least you could go outside.
Right.
Play with your friends.
Right.
Go to school.
Right.
Do the things that kids would normally do.
Right.
So, yes, this is the first time in, well, history, as far as I know.
But adults were locked down, too. I mean, it's affected everybody. Of course, we want to worry about the kids first because of stunting their growth, and they have to have social development, of course, and what have you, and just learning to grow up and just the freedom of being a child. But this fucked up the adult world, too, man.
But
you know, we were all locked down for a minute.
I would say, you know.
And suffered.
The thing that's really counterintuitive about all of it is that this is we're dawning on a new age.
Mm-hmm.
So there's clearly some people that are against that. You know, they're against progress.
Mm-hmm.
They're against freedom.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a part of time. This is the age of Aquarius that we're about to come to in 2021.
The dawning of the age of Aquarius.
The age of Aquarius.
We're in it. We're all up in it.
We're all up in it. That, you know, 1969 is when that song came out. That's
69.
The year I was born.
The fifth dimension.
Right. And that's it. We're all like moving forward in progress. We're in another dimension. We're still waiting for these other people to come along with us. And they're just so resistant.
I'm not waiting on nobody, man. Fuck these motherfuckers.
They're so resistant. And I just think that no matter what they try to do to bring humanity down to their, you know, what they want it to be, they're not going to be able to stop the progress because it's just the force, you know, and we're going to use the force to just like wipe out all the negativity. And no matter what they try to do, they're going to have to overcome us in this next age.
Who is us?
And we're going to win.
These days and these us's. I didn't sign.
You didn't sign up for any of them
with me.
They know who I'm talking to.
Oh, God.
Peace
you
could, in the East.
They could comment right here.
Yeah.
And like and subscribe.
What
do
you see
Radio,
yourself
YouTube.
Doing in the next age? Because no matter what they do with their viruses or whatever, we're moving forward and we're going to fight for freedom in
damn,
the coming
I'm
age.
On your side, Steph.
Right on.
I'm signing up.
Right on.
Motivational consultant for the Las Vegas Raiders. Sign her up. Anyway, what else did you have? You had more review for the year?
No, that was pretty much it. It sucked. That was my review for the year. You know, I'd like to see this get over with, too, and see what we're on to the next. As of right now, the virus is still highly politicized, and everyone's being held hostage as far as their money and their work and what they can do. There's still obviously no games and no big no concerts, the things that we love to do.
Right.
We'll see how that goes in 2021. But
right
now,
years.
I don't see a number on it. I just see basically we're still kind of the same situation. I don't see light at the end of the tunnel.
The business is going on as usual.
Okay.
New York City, Florida, here in Las Vegas. You know, they're gearing up for New Year's. You know, stages are being set. Here in Vegas, you'll be able to go down to Fremont Street. There won't be any live performances, but you'll have to pay a $25 security charge to walk up and down Fremont and be a part of that.
You have to pay $25 to go on Fremont Street?
Yeah, for New Year's. For New Year's. For New Year's. There will be some activity on the Strip, like it is every year. There are going to be road closures throughout the city beginning early Thursday morning. and on the Strip area, and then New York City, Times Square, they, you know, getting the ball ready and what have you, and some of the other major locations, Sydney, Australia, that always has a big New Year's party, Japan, you know,
well,
Beijing,
have
China.
Well, they have people there in New York?
Yeah. Okay. They're setting up Times Square. They're expecting people. I mean, I don't know how they're going to do it, but, yeah. You know, that's what's up.
What's up?
Well, since that's what's up.
Meanwhile, L.A. is closed.
Yeah, all of
that motherfucker is closed.
California shut down. Well, as we normally do here, because we're very normal here at Raider Fan Radio, we like to do our dedication this evening. We do have a dedication. Here's the irony behind this one, though, because this is a name that Raider Rob brought up just only a couple shows ago on show 11, who could potentially be our defensive coordinator for the future. And that would be one Kevin Green. I've always been a Kevin Green fan. When you mentioned him, I was very stoked that you even brought him up, just because, you know, there's so many great players in the NFL. And we look back on the history and the mythology of the NFL. We look at the storylines that go with it, too, but most of all, so the characters that go with it, too. And Kevin Green, I mean, he was like the Hulk Hogan for the NFL.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's just my best way of describing, not only with just the long hair and the bit of the look, but just the way he kind of carried himself, the energy that he always brought to every team he was on.
Yeah.
Aside from being a great player, he was an individual. Very strong minded when it came to military because of his family background, but he was also free spirited and carefree to go along with it too. But when he was on the field and he was out there chasing down quarterbacks, he was a force of nature.
Yeah,
that's my best way to
one of the all time dominant defensive ends and linemen. Of course, began his career with the Carolina Panthers. He was drafted by them. And then went on
and they
to
start with the Rams.
The Rams, my bad. And then ended up going to the Panthers and then ending his career somewhat with the Steelers.
Right.
Or it might be flip-flop there. But
we made it to the Super Bowl with the Steelers.
Yeah,
made it
to the Super Bowl with the Steelers and, of course, was paired with Greg Lloyd and that great line that they had there for a while. Rod Woodson, of course, in the defensive backfield at the time and Cornell Lake. And, you know, just a formidable, you know, beast of a player, a throwback player to just the real physical defensive end, you know, the Howie Longs, those type of guys, man. And he's just, you know, a guy that, Stone, like you said, had that World Wrestling Federation type vibe about him, real intensity, and then went into coaching. And I have to give you all a correction, too. I had mentioned a couple of shows ago about him when we were talking about possible defensive coordinators, and I had him on the list. He had been the defensive coordinator with the Jets up until 2018.
Okay.
And so that was not his defense that we beat in New York. Well, some of the remnants of it with some of the linebackers and players that had been under him in 18. But correction to all of you out there, he was not the coach when we played the Jets a few weeks ago. But anyway, man, sad loss.
You know,
sad
Joe,
loss.
One of our viewers, a good friend, longtime good, great friends, Joey, a.k.a. Raider Stump.
Stumpy!
He contacted me around Christmas, you know, when he heard about Kevin Green. Like I said, we're all big Kevin Green fans, and we all followed his career. And he said, didn't Raider Rob just mention Kevin Green? I thought, yeah, man, it's kind of gnarly that, you know, Raider Rob throws a name out there.
I'd be on it, man.
And all of a sudden, that name's not there anymore. Mm-hmm. And then ironically, just that next day, get another email here, a comment at Raider Fan Radio.
Comment, like, and
subscribe. Dear Raider Rob, I'm a big fan and love your Raider Rob rants. I love your passion for the Raiders and watch you on YouTube every week. But in regards to your defensive coordinator position, considering what happened to Kevin Green, please refrain from mentioning me for the position. I'd like to pursue a long and happy, fruitful life. Your fan, Mike Singletary.
Well,
the curse of Raider Rob lives on.
That guy had pre-existing conditions. None of them were Raider Rob. Okay, no. God bless you, Kevin
really
Green
sad.
And the Green
it's like
family.
We're taking a hit.
And our
boy.
Prayers go out to you.
We're taking a hit, our generation. You know, he's not even 60 years
he's
old.
He's 58 years old.
Not even 60.
Too young.
And
man.
Then just the few people that we've dedicated the show to over the course of the last 12 shows, a lot of them have been young.
So, you know, take care of yourself. That's the bottom line, man, and just treasure life. As it relates to the Raiders, They treasured life through 9 games. They treasured the possibilities here in Las Vegas for 9 games. And unfortunately, last week, that promise came to a halt against the Miami Dolphins. Our Las Vegas Raiders are officially eliminated from the NFL playoffs.
I felt the
CFL
Colts,
playoffs.
The Colts game
the lingerie
was...
football league playoffs. Okay. Montana semi-pro league playoffs. Okay. And Nevada Division IV high school final. Okay. All of those. The Las Vegas Raiders are eliminated from, including the NFL.
They won't be in any of those
playoffs. No.
I felt our playoff game, our first playoff game, was the Colts game.
Yeah, you said
and that was a very telling game. And unfortunately, and even though mathematically, as they say, you know, being mathematically, you're still in it. But when you have
not anymore.
But yeah, but when you have that kind of game, and then obviously the Chargers after that, the game where Derek Carr pulled his nut muscle and Marcus Mariota came in, they still could have almost won that game too. But even then, it's like when you I'm watching football like you all are all the time, and I see all these teams right now, they're in the playoff hunt. And December football, as we say, and now December's over, that's when you play your best football. That's when you get your momentum going into the playoff season. Right. If you're not playing your best football, I mean, even the Steelers were starting to get a little slide there. Luckily for them,
they
caught back.
They
went back on track, and they just won a game again. But still, the bottom line is, if you're not winning games in December, you're not looking at your best. You play through the whole season to become who you are in December to make it into the playoffs.
Well, looking at that game was, you know, I was so pissed because that is just clearly not Raider football. I mean, what Josh Jacobs did when he had the opportunity to score, obviously listening to his coach, you know, tell him to, you know, just dive down here, just stop, you know, break yourself. We want to give ourselves just enough room to kick a field goal. And then they were over on the sideline, glad-handed. Yeah, we got him. And I was thinking, no, don't do that. Never
Gruden,
play to lose.
Gruden,
play to lose.
Gruden lost this game. And I've been on your jock. I got your back. You're one of my favorites. As I keep saying, I'm one of the first fans to meet you at Weeks Park in Hayward at the Run Run Jones Celebrity Golf Softball Game when they bought you out the front office to meet some of the fans and the Raiders and your first public introduction to all of us in 1998. Wanted you to come back. That's on the record.
For 16 years.
You know, so I'm in your corner, and I still believe you're the coach to get us to a Super Bowl and win it. Okay, but
not
you fucked that
shit.
Game off, homeboy. You tricked that game off. That was not
was
Raider
dumb.
Football.
Score
okay?
touchdowns.
You score touchdowns. You always get more points, maximum points in any game.
I know.
You want as many points as possible, all right, in any situation, and trust your
yes.
defense. And you didn't do that. Yeah, they're playing bad. Yes, they've been Swiss cheese for most of that second half of the season, all right? And that game there, a lot of tackles still being missed, bad angles, what have you. But if defenses win championship, as the cliche goes, then it's those type of games where your defense has to step up to prove or at least make a statement that they're a team and a defensive unit that can be a playoff contending defensive unit. It's the same way when it comes to the clutch moments when we're talking about number four having to get it in, okay, or win the game. All right, it's the same dynamic on the other side of the field. You just fired Marinelli. Okay, and then Gunther, fuck around here, and Marinelli has 2 weeks, defense is looking a little better in certain spots or what have you, but then offensively, at the command of the ship, you cop to this fucking etho in the NFL with these sabermetrics and these damn computerized graphics and analytics about what you should do in what certain situation. Man, we don't play football, motherfucker. We play Raider football.
Yes.
And Raider football is to score whenever there's a score possible. Yep. Not this lay down shit and get right in the center of the field so your damn dude can hit a field goal.
Al Davis would have never gone for that.
That was bullshit. That was bullshit. That was sissy ball. That was that NFC bullshit. And that was that playing it safe shit. You're not getting nowhere, John, playing it safe. It's time to stop being scared and coaching scared in critical moments.
I mean, why would
okay?
you be scared?
You've already got one hampering where you've got a subpar quarterback. Okay? And you've got a defense that needs greatly to be greatly improved. But, homie, that ain't Raider football.
No, it's not. And Crunch texts me during the game. We usually text back and forth.
That was some bullshit.
He said, I passed out in the second half only to wake up to Gruden saying the loss is a reflection of him. Mark needs to admit his mistake and fire Gruden or sell the team to someone who will. And that's Crunch. Okay. And no matter what I said, I couldn't talk him down.
I know like, some
fire
people.
Gruden.
Now, yeah, I'll take the other side of it.
Yeah,
because I agree with everything you all
Satan's
said.
Satan's advocate
when
over
I
here.
Was feeling, and I was feeling it at the moment. Yes, of course, I want to score touchdowns, but I also saw the fact that yeah, you're right. He doesn't trust because there's no reason, first of all, to trust the defense. It is the
but don't
worst,
trust him with a lead then.
It is the
don't
worst,
trust him with a 7-point lead.
It is the worst defense in the NFL.
They had no timeouts, dude. You're in the same situation which you ended up getting burned in that the Jets were in 3 weeks prior. You didn't go three. You should have went 3-2 5. 3-2-6. And keep the game. So the guy gets that long catch.
When it comes to
and then within field goal range
at the
that
end
doesn't happen if you have 7 points.
I think that if you would have went for the touchdown, then yes, then the other team has to. Then the Dolphins would have had to score a touchdown,
right?
To
exactly.
Win the game.
Yes.
I understand that. I understand.
They
that.
Had no timeout.
Like I said, believe me, I didn't sleep that night. Like most of everybody out there right now,
yeah.
I was trying to like
wrap some propofol.
I'm wrapping my brain around it. I just couldn't sleep at night. But then I thought, then I
slept well.
I also kept thinking to myself. 19 seconds, and I know Raider Man's out there, 19. Yes, Raider Man, I'm thinking about you. Number 19. 19 seconds, no timeouts. The Dolphins should not even have been able to put two plays, maybe, try to throw the ball
exactly.
Downfield.
Mm-hmm.
And they should have been able to defend that without any problem. For them to, for the weirdest, craziest situation, for Ryan Fitzpatrick, who, by the way, came in, you have to give the credit to the Dolphins who made
like
the adjustment.
Relief pitcher. Like a relief pitcher for the Yankees.
He just came in one quarter and all of a sudden won
like,
the game.
Oh, yeah.
But when he went back and threw that pass, I mean, not only was he way back and he just threw it as far as he could and lucky got his guy downfield, Arden Key, who I've been now criticizing,
yeah,
or now hardcore criticizing, okay, to grab his face mask and literally twist it off his head almost, rip his head off. I mean, those things put together in 19 seconds. It was that to me, that's a culmination of exactly why, in my mind, why Gruden does not trust his defense for anything. They did the same thing.
Okay,
with
but
the
if you're
Falcons,
not going to trust them,
Jets,
don't trust them with a 7-point lead then. At least you're giving yourself an out. And again, we can go off of stats. We can go off of previous games. Football is played in the moment, just like life. What we just did 30 seconds ago, we're not going to do 30 seconds from now.
Right.
It's over. Okay? So whatever the stats you come into with at a situation like that, the seasonal stats, the rank 30th in defense and run stop, whatever the fuck it is, it still has nothing to do with that moment. Has nothing to do with that next play where they are still professional athletes. They are in the heat of a game. They know it's a clutch moment. And you don't know what's going to happen. The thing with us and the thing that has always been the Oakland Raiders, a holy roller anyone, goes to the post. Like,
right?
And I know that I'm talking about old shit, but I'm saying the mentality
because it was
has
better.
To be that we are never out of a game.
Play to the end of the
you
game.
You play to the
right.
end of the game. And the objective
only
is
score.
To score more points. Than your opponent.
Right.
And having three with them with a chance to win is not scoring more, but those are not good odds.
No.
Not even in fucking Reno or Sparks. Okay, those are not good odds.
Yeah.
Let alone right here at the fucking Mirage. All right, or Caesar's Palace. Those are not good odds. What sense does that make? Particularly with them with no timeouts. You don't trust your defense to be able to cover for 19 seconds? Fine. Okay, but at least give them the opportunity.
Right. But
don't let them die on a hill that they didn't get to fight for. Off of a field goal. That's not fair, man.
But all of you are saying he didn't trust his defense. He shouldn't have trusted them anyway because they're no good.
They're horrible.
But you didn't even trust your offense. You could have scored a touchdown. Josh, that was reminding me of Seattle and the freaking fake Patriots in the Super Bowl. When Seattle had an opportunity, why didn't you run Marshawn Lynch? He would have scored.
You could have had Russell Wilson.
Russell Wilson could have scored.
Yeah,
we were right, and we were at the one because Josh stopped listening to him. You know, you really messed him up. Just the whole, you just stop listening to your coaches when they tell you something stupid. You're a football player, you're a professional, you're making money, you know the game. And so whatever they're afraid of, you prove them wrong, and they'll be mad at you later after you've scored that touchdown. They'll have to give you your props.
Yeah, well, Raider Nation's mad now, and particularly here in Las Vegas. I'm back to this again with you, Chucky. Okay, on some real shit, homeboy. All right, I personally want a certain quarterback, which I am going on our next show, reveal the trade and what it would take to possibly get this guy. And then for me, as much as I love you, as much as I've met you, know your wife, saw your sons grow up,
right,
partially in the Bay.
He's behind you, he made that.
I've met you many times, you come out of the black hole, you know who the fuck I am, I know who you are. So all that aside, homeboy, this is a business. And it's big business here in Vegas. And once again, this team's got to get splashy. It's got to get exciting, okay, to make it here in Las Vegas.
That was
all right,
really,
and that was bullshit football right there. And so for me personally, if we're able to acquire this quarterback I want or another quarterback, okay, that is serviceable, that would be considered a guy that could take the Raiders or any football team to a playoff and to a Super Bowl, I would say you got 2 years with him.
Yeah.
And if something ain't done, man, and this offense don't perk up and you find an identity and there's a consistency in winning, by 25, man, it's time for you to fucking go too.
Yeah.
On some real shit. This is pussy ball, dude. And we're not playing pussy ball. Yeah. And this ain't a pussy town. Okay? This is a town of excitement, of glamour and glitz, and of money, of revenue generated. The fucking Nevada sports books in November set a record with $61.8 million revenue that came in. We back, baby. All right? The sports books in Nevada. This is a money town, man. Okay? And you're going to have to hold your own over there at the Death Star. And this ain't the way to show it.
Yeah.
All right? This is not going to sell. All right, and like Crunch said, have to get somebody in here that understands what time it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this ain't Oakland no more. This ain't fucking punk-ass Tampa Bay. This is Las Vegas. And whether they've had a pro football team or not, they understand the business of sports. Your motto is the Golden Knights. That's the template that is set in this city for professional sports. And whether the NBA comes here, Major League Baseball, or you continue to be here, they did it right. That's the template, a well-run organization. It is infused in the community, and they put a team together, even as an expansion team, that went out and competed and won.
Right.
In their first year. What the fuck are you doing with a 61-year legacy of the silver and black? And this is your second go-around. You know what this shit is about, John. Stop fucking around, man.
Right.
Okay?
To add to that, again, it's not even the devil's advocate. It's just kind of more of just my big picture of the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like I'm almost kind of glad we didn't go to the Super Bowl or anything like that this year.
Well, you weren't going to the Super Bowl this year.
With this whole COVID situation affecting our team and our grand inaugural opening. I mean, it's just been a weird, fucked up situation since the beginning, and it's been like you said. It's like you're going along, you're learning and doing things along the way as they happen. We're all living in the moment to get where we want to go.
Yeah.
No matter how great your offense is, until your defense is great, it doesn't matter anyways to me. You can look back at all the great quarterbacks in NFL history that have made it to Super Bowls and won Super Bowls. They had great defenses to go along with it. It's just, to me, you got to have a great defense. And I've been saying that now every single year we draft. I already got my eyes on this next draft. I'm looking at guys. You know, we always are. I was kind of a little bit disappointed we didn't pick up Kenneth Murray. We took Damon Arnett instead. That's on the general manager, Mike Mayock.
Right.
Those are his decisions, and I live by them all the time. But we all still do our, you know, armchair quarterback draft specialists, and we look at other guys out there making, you know, playing good football,
right,
wondering why don't we got that guy?
Right.
But year after year, we don't go after that free agent defensive tackle. We don't go over that free agent defensive back that might be a veteran in the league.
Right.
But back to what you just said as far as, you know, talking about John Gruden.
But we also don't go after big box office players. I mean, over the last 15 years, we missed a chance to get Anquan Boldin.
Al Davis
is not here.
We
chance to possibly get Drew Brees. We missed some other free agents. Marty Schottenheimer fucked us off of Dion. Okay, we did get Randy Moss and all that. But we've got to get a cat coming out of college and get somebody that can put butts in the seats.
Yeah.
Okay, it's time for the Raiders to return to big time selling football. Okay, this is sports entertainment now. Goodell really put the stamp on that a few weeks ago and claimed it that, all right? And that's what it is. And here in Las Vegas, the optimum number one industry is entertainment. No matter what it is, I don't care if you got two snakes racing down the strip. It's entertainment. It's going to be festive. They're going to be dancing girls.
There is going to be dancing girls. There ain't no fucking around here, man.
Yeah. Okay, so it's time to put your big boy.
I think
pants
after
on.
This experience this year, I mean, just
and realize what time it is.
I think there's going to be some serious soul searching here after this last game against Denver in that front office. And just looking at what they got and where they want to go with all this. And based on all the things you said, I mean, I agree with you. That's the hype of where it's all going, what it's supposed to be.
What do you
want to
see change going into next year?
Well, before I say that, though, I just saying that before, and I do have some changes. But I think going into next year with hopefully some fans in the stands and a new revamped defense, because obviously the defense is going from the top to the bottom, from the coordinator down to all the players. There's going to be discussion. But I think it's going to be a different whole big picture of where we could be and where we will be. I don't think it's going to be like this year. But as far as what needs to be done, I've been saying it, I'm going to say it again.
Yeah.
We got to get that defense going. We got to go out and get the best defensive tackle, free agent available. I've already got that. I'm working on my – we're going to do our roundtable show here with some Raider fans after the final game of the season when we get together and talk about the future. But that's where I'm going to be starting. I'm already starting with the defense.
Okay.
I think we need to get some veteran leadership pretty much at every position on defense. Everyone. I don't trust Damon Arnette and Javon Mullen. I think they're great young talent. I don't trust them. And obviously, the Gruden doesn't trust them. The coaches don't trust them. All right? I don't trust our linebackers. Our defensive tackles, we've got probably one of the worst defensive tackle squads. Our starters are backups somewhere else. Yeah. Our starters should be our backups right now.
Well, for me, it always starts with coaching, as we say. And for me, I believe the Raiders need to get Raider-Fied.
Raider-Fied?
Raider-Fied.
How do you Raider-Fy?
Okay, let's get Raider-Fied. Let's get Raider-Fied.
Let's get Raider-Fied.
Let's get Raider-Fied. Let's get Raider-Fied. Raider-Fied means we need to go out and bring in some coaching talent as key positions that are former Raiders.
Much like Willie Brown for many years.
Right.
All right.
Terry Robiskie.
Tom Flores became head coach.
We need to infuse the Raider attitude from the inside out. And it starts with the coaching. And I personally believe that, you know, when it comes to, say, like a linebacking coach, bring in Bill Romanowski. Bring in a Bill Romanowski or see what Rod Martin's up to.
I just saw Bill Romanowski on that movie with Adam Sandler, The Longest Yard remake. Love Bill Romanowski,
that was a piece of
man.
Shit, but anyway, but yeah.
Bill Romanowski is the one, probably out of all the Raiders, or even football, in football history, where you hated him so much when he was on the other team.
Yeah.
But when he came to your team, then he became one of your favorite players.
But when he got on our team, he didn't slack or have kind of a dissonant attitude like a Warren Sapp or Randy Moss or fucking Rich Gannon. He came in and assumed the role of a Raider.
He took out Shannon Sharp.
Yeah.
He dislocated his elbow.
Took out Jake Plummer. Took out Bobby Brister one afternoon. Took out a lot of people. But, you know, as far as being a coach with the Raiders, and like I said, us having to have an attitude that is Raider-Fied, that, you know, the mentality, they almost have to be like a cult-like thinking over there at 1475.
Yeah.
Let me give you another one. Defensive back coach. I would love to see the Raiders pursue the wine king, Charles Woodson.
Mr. Woodson.
Personal friend.
Now, has Charles Woodson done any coaching at this point?
No. Who gives a fuck?
I'm just asking.
No, he hasn't done any coaching
at
this
point. I haven't seen him doing
any. You know, but he knows football.
Yeah. Right.
And he knows playing DBs. Okay, and he commands attention and respect.
When he came,
he's a Super Bowl champion.
When he came to the Raiders the second time around, which to me is one of the great moves ever in Raider history, bringing back Charles Woodson.
Yeah,
he's a Raider.
But that defense got better.
Yeah.
The defensive, that's what I meant by that, bringing in that veteran leadership at the defensive back position earlier just a little while ago. You got, when you bring in, say, a Charles Woodson or a player of that caliber, all of a sudden the players around him.
Right.
It's why I mentioned Richard Sherman. Although Richard Sherman's not the player he was, when you get that kind of guy in the room with your young guys.
Leadership.
You don't have to always just focus on only what the defensive back coach or the head coach is saying.
Right.
You've got someone right there at the moment.
Right.
Telling these kids, this is what you got to do. And setting an example.
And along that line at DB, too, a friend of the show, real great friend of the show, would be another one, Gerard Cooper. Now, Gerard Cooper may not have been a big name to you guys, but the thing that Gerard Cooper was he understood the nuances, okay, of playing DB. Where Charles is an alpha DB, Gerard is an alpha educated defensive back. He was a smart player, okay, a very mentally, viscerally mental type player, okay, and was physical as well. Also a dude that commands respect and knows the game real well, okay. The one thing about the Raiders over the years, from Todd Christensen, Snake Stabler, to Jim Otto, all the way to the future with Charles Woodson and what have you, we've had smart football players.
Yes.
Okay, smart football players.
Right.
Okay, you know, collectively, through years, there have been, you know, times when we sucked, of course, but we've had smart players on our team. Mm-hmm. The defensive line, okay, that really needs to be ramped up.
I like this
like
list.
This man said.
Right? Okay. It's feeling good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
One man I would look into who I got a personal demonstration of some of the techniques that were being taken out of the game. Okay, and some of the techniques that were being instituted that he totally was against, and I totally love the techniques that he was for. This was in a parking lot in Oakland about 7 years ago. The great Greg Townsend
of
the
Los Angeles Raiders. That's who I have for D-line coach.
As a defensive line. That's who you got too?
That's who I got for D-line coach. I mean, he should have been considered years ago. And like, he's, you know, they should have approached him and been like, dude, we need you. You know, clearly you're around. You can be involved. You can be great at not only coaching the team, but also teaching the Raider technique, which a lot of players clearly on our D-line don't have. They don't have that fight. And we have over the years.
And respect to the Los Angeles Raider Nation down there, but during those years in L.A., yeah, about 8 out of those 13 years, we had some of the most formidable defensive
linemen. That's one of the best defenses,
that we had down there with Howie Long, Bill Piquel, Scott Davis. You know, I'm talking about the defensive line.
Bill Piquel.
Also, in that vein of defensive line coach, John Perella. We all remember John Perella.
Yes.
Early 2000s team. Chuck, you remember. I'm calling back to 2000, okay, to see if we can get some of that type of attitude back and those type of guys to come coach. Hello, 2001. Will you come coach some of you guys on that team? Yes, the 2021 Raiders? Yes, John Perella would be one. He's recently been a coach, a defensive line coach at the University of Nebraska.
I've always been surprised.
So he's already in the mix with coaching.
Okay. I'm surprised why Coach Gruden did not decide to keep Rod Woodson, who would be my guy that I always bring up. Because Rod Woodson did coach for the Raiders defensive backs up until Gruden came around, and then all of a sudden he was gone. So for some reason that didn't work out.
Something
he had his other guy in mind. But Rod Woodson, to me, is like one of the smartest defensive backs ever. He's in the Hall of Fame because of it. He did it with every team he was with, including the Raiders. Rod Woodson single-handedly made the one big play that changed the course
against
of the season against Denver that got us to the Super Bowl.
Yes.
That was one of the most amazing plays ever. I don't know if it was 99-yard, but the run back or the interception. But that was indicative of what he always did.
Right.
Even when he wasn't at his prime youth-wise, physically, he knew the field. He knows what's going on. And that's obviously apparently the problem that our defensive backs, young defensive backs, don't have right now. That everyone keeps saying, oh, they're out of place. They don't know where to be.
Right.
Well, then they need to get someone to make them know where to be.
That's right.
Help them out, man. Right. Get them out there.
Now,
make sure they're
Raider-Fied.
The piece de resistance.
The piece de resistance.
As Stone has just mentioned, and we've talked about through these years, we are sitting on one of the up-and-coming and emerging top running backs in the National Football League, in Josh Jacobs.
Uh-oh.
And Josh Jacobs needs to be molded in the Raider mode, but also in the mode of great backs, because like the Marshall Faulk, which is a mode that he fits into, the Marshawn Lynch's, which is another mode that he
you
fits into.
You put him
into,
up there with the Emmitt Smith backs, a couple times.
Emmitt Smith. Okay, he needs to have toolage from some greats.
Okay.
And so at running back coach, if I could have my way and would advise Mayock and Chucky, I would look into bringing in one, Ricky Williams, who was not a Raider, but almost was.
We wanted him to be a Raider.
We wanted him, and it's ironic that we were doing our show at the time, the first incarnation, and when he got released and was going through his little weed shit after the Dolphins, I mentioned on our show that we should go after Ricky Williams when he's ready to come back to the NFL. A week after that, Ricky Williams in an interview, when asked when he gets through with his suspension, what team would he most like to play for when he comes back to the NFL, and it was the Oakland Raiders at the time. You don't remember that?
We know well. We all
I got it on one of those tapes.
We all campaigned hardcore for Ricky. Well, first of all, we all defended and stood up for Ricky Williams just because of the way he got fucked by the NFL.
Right.
Okay. Period. When it came to
But he's not the piece
and all of a sudden, and all of a sudden everyone's smoking in the NFL and it's all legal.
But they were back then.
I mean,
too.
The hypocrisy behind all that.
Right.
But aside from that, real quick, he was a dominating force of nature running back.
And college and football.
Who moved the pile. We watched him all the way, like you said, from college into
smart
to his
player.
Pro.
Really
and
smart player.
And it was
player.
Only because of this. Only because of this. They fucked him so hard and destroyed his
but
career.
But it used it to help him get out of what he had, which was a lot of anxiety and social anxiety.
Yes.
The man, after playing in Canada and retiring from football and really getting into the cannabis industry, was able to come out of that and become a very personable, buoyant, colorful guy. Out of that, he's no longer in that shy mode and that resistance.
He's better for it now.
He's better for it, and that's the type
of
person
cool.
you would want because he's a motivational person. He has gone over some obstacles personally, and a lot of these players are dealing with it too because the game is mental again. But he's not the piece de resistance.
He's not the piece de resistance.
I don't know if Marcus Allen would be in the coach. And Marcus Allen always struck me as a guy that might be a little too above being a coach. You know what I'm saying? So I wouldn't think Marcus
Allen. He would have been coaching by now if he was going to coach.
But the piece de resistance, and I see him sometimes, he pops up doing things for Auburn, hanging out at Little League baseball games, and fishing.
Uh-oh.
He's basically doing much of nothing at all. But he's a guy.
I'm trying to think.
He's a guy who loves being around the game. Who loved playing for the Raiders.
What position?
And when I'm talking about making big splashy moves, he was a big splashy move for the Raiders in Los Angeles. And that's the type of move I'm talking about we need to make in this 2021 draft. I would say reach out to Vincent Bo Jackson.
Man.
And see if he wouldn't mind coming and being a running backs coach for the Las Vegas
Raiders.
Okay, now
look, I love all these ideas. I think it's creative and it gets me excited, something to think about. Like, what could happen here when we go into
Bo
the
Jackson running back coach. Let's get to that. Bo Jackson running back
I
coach.
Believe.
And conditioning coach, too.
I know that. I don't just believe and think, but I know that whenever we get past the virus, whatever it is, these restrictions and all these things and distancing and not being able to let players and people in the building. I mean, that new headquarters is tailor-made and built for all these guys to come and be under
and put
one
their energy on it.
And as I recall, Al Davis was the one. I mean, this is all in the mold of Al Davis. I mean, the stadium, the torch, the actual facility itself. Al Davis always spoke a lot about how he imagined a football academy.
Yes.
A building that was a school for football of every position for coaches, everybody. And to me, that new building that they just built, that they haven't even let anybody in yet, is built for that.
Right there.
And you're going to see all those guys.
Yeah, well, you need some professors of the game in that motherfucker to make it an educational
institution. That's true, yes, for sure.
You know what I'm saying? And so the same way it was at Oakport Road back to the 60s and the 70s where the Raiders were, and of course out of 1220, you know, that same mantra was still there, even though it didn't always show up on the field. The mentality was there because Mr. Davis was still alive. And again, you know, I don't try to rag Mark Davis too much or all in because,
he's
you know, we all going to have to come to a head here on some personal shit soon. So whatever with them motherfuckers over there. But I'm talking about the coaching staff. I'm talking about the motherfuckers that I know and care about, which is John Gruden, okay? And Mike Mayock, who I wanted, who I admired for years from afar with the NFL Network, of course, with his prognosticating and his deal-making and what have you, and how he understands the nuances of the business of the game and how to put a team together, okay, and what pieces you need. Those two things need to show up in April and going forward next year. Okay, it's time for both of y'all to shit or get off the fucking pot. Okay, enough with the big talk, you know, and all this and the glad handing and all the, you know, accolades and pleasantries, man. You two motherfuckers together collectively have got to put a winning team on the field that is a contender going forward, that is an explosive, exciting, efficient, smart, and dominating football team, man, for the city of Las Vegas and the Raider legacy, period. Okay, don't fuck off this opportunity. All right, on our as we started, you know, with this bullshit. Now, real quick, I just want to say this because you know Stone's got number four covered, whatever. But you motherfuckers is covering for him, okay? Like Tony Romo, sorry. Why do we have to listen to loser quarterbacks comment
during our
on
broadcast?
Football?
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
What's up with that?
Tony Romo was a bum. All right, went to one playoff game and fumbled it away on the 1 yard line against Seattle. Fuck Tony Romo.
Oh, he was a guy.
Why am I listening to Tony Romo? Okay,
dude, he's very forgetful.
Another one is Rich Gannon's weak ass. Whenever they have him on our fucking show, okay, he's another one.
You don't like
one.
Him, Rich Gannon? I like
Hell
Rich Gannon.
No.
You would.
I'm a big Gannon fan. I love Gannon.
You're a diplomat. You know,
no, I like the way Rich Gannon. I mean, okay.
You like the way he always talks.
You're always gonna remind me of the six.
You like the way he
interceptions.
You like the way he always talks shit about the Raiders and takes his little jabs at him when he does Raider games, and is always complaining about they're not good here, and they're not good here, and they got to get better here.
He knows. He's been a good Raider.
He threw five fucking touchdowns in the Super Bowl. Fuck Rich Gannon.
You mean
interceptions. Fuck you, too. You can go kick it with his ass.
Rich Gannon got us to the Super Bowl.
Kurt Warner.
Those are some great games along the way.
Kurt Warner, with your wild-ass, wicked, crazy wife and whatever the fuck you're talking about this past weekend, okay, about he's our best
option
to win,
Joker-ish.
Okay, and all this over. All you motherfuckers covering for that clown, I'm not buying it. This clown can buy it, and everybody else can buy it. I know what you're doing because I've been watching the media when it relates to the Raiders for years. And whenever we have somebody sorry or somebody comparable,
they like
okay?
it.
I remember when y'all were trying to figure out a way that, you know, convince us that T. Martin might be a good quarterback for us when he was a backup. Okay, I know what you're doing. The rest of these Raider fans may not. Okay, he's a mediocre quarterback. And when you're sitting there praising him about his mediocrity after seven seasons, not much of an improvement, what you're basically saying with reverse psychology is, oh, Raiders, don't be a bonehead team. You've been losing so much.
Enjoy
and every
it.
Once in a while you
You'll
get good
better.
Players. And he's a good player. Just give him some more time. Okay, he's your best option. Translates to, we want you to be mediocre.
Mm-hmm.
We want your team to stay mediocre. The NFL fears the Raiders rising up again and dominating this league, and we will again. Okay, we will. All right, trust me. Somehow, some way. All right, but until then, fuck all of y'all covering for him. All right, he's a mediocre quarterback, and you want us to stay mediocre. And that ain't going to happen.
No,
and it shouldn't happen.
I think Derek Carr has improved over the past few years. On
would any of you motherfuckers start your team with him? Hold on, man. Would any of you motherfuckers start your team with Derek Carr?
Yeah, I would.
That's because you don't know a goddamn thing about football. You would start your team with Derek Carr instead of Justin Herbert.
Right now, I didn't. Well, now you're giving me comparisons to other people. Right now.
Well, who are you going to compare
right
him to
now,
that you, this, wouldn't, you wouldn't take
at
over
at this point in time?
And
first
I'm just
of all,
fussing with Stone.
No, I understand. I understand 100%. And they do. We all understand because I think the frustration's out there. And but I'm focused on where I'm at.
Okay,
I know who you want in the draft, and I know why, and all those reasons. I also know in my mind we're not going to get that guy. If we get that guy, great. I'll move with it. I'm forward with it.
Energy,
right now,
focus.
If I look across the NFL, and I know we're going to break down a little bit about the NFL too. There's not really many guys, first of all, that would be available anytime soon that you would want. And the ones that are going to be available here soon,
you
don't even want them. I don't want no Matthew Stafford. There's not a lot of guys out there in the
NFL
that are ready to come and be a starter for the Raiders.
They got you, too. I hope that Kool-Aid
unless you're going to get Lamar Jackson, Patrick Mahomes,
or Justin Herbert. What does silver and black Kool-Aid taste like?
Your boy and
what
a
does silver and black Kool-Aid taste like?
Is Josh Allen. I would love to get any of those guys.
But what does silver and black Kool-Aid taste like?
It tastes good. I'm drinking it right now. I drink
but
it all the time.
To continue.
I see the world through silver and black colored glasses, and I drink the Raider Kool-Aid. Yes.
Good.
But again, if I saw somebody out there right now that I could replace,
you're not looking and you're not imaginative enough.
I'm
you're,
looking right
you're
across
the
NFL.
You're the symptom of the
okay.
problem. You're not. Mm-hmm. We just mentioned Bo Jackson. The Raiders have a history of going after big time. We made a trade for Mike Haynes in 1978.
Who in the NFL do you want to start for the Raiders that's available in the NFL right
Aaron
now?
Aaron Rodgers.
Okay, that's interesting. It's creative. I don't see them the Green Bay letting go of Aaron Rodgers.
You don't know
anything.
You don't know. I'm offering him a bit of building the table.
Yeah, it's an
you're a defeatist.
That's the first time you threw it on the table.
But
to
you ain't thinking that way. You're ready to settle for the 7 years. 7 years. Well, how much more time do you need?
Another seven years.
If I thought I could get Aaron Rodgers.
How much
Rodgers,
more time do you need?
If I thought I could get Aaron Rodgers realistically, I would.
Why
go along with
you?
That. Because I'm not feeling it.
There are a multitude of quarterbacks out here, Stone.
Okay, you named Aaron Rodgers. There's one. Who's another one?
But I mean, it's
one?
College, and it's not just who I want. There are a lot of college guys that are coming out that are good quarterbacks.
Aside from the guy that
it
you
It ain't
want.
Dwayne Haskins doing. You better not
Wait. Do you mean Jamarcus Russell Jr.?
Man,
yeah.
Jameis Winston Jr.
Yeah. Crab legs.
He's still in cans of crab. That's how the course of a quarterback
the bar's
is.
Up there, and I always see you reaching for it and higher, and I don't argue with that.
I'm not done.
But
I'm not done.
I still
you could
believe.
Possibly put a trade on the table for Matt Ryan. You could possibly put a trade on the table for Matt Ryan.
All right, well, he's got his answers. Matt Ryan isn't a bad idea either. But then again, man, just to come in.
And that's why we'll keep losing, because Chucky's over there with the but then again.
Yeah.
And that's why we keep losing, because the but then
look
again.
Look at what's happening.
And that energy is superseding the energy of fuck all that old excuse making, no apologies, no excuses. Make moves. You don't know unless you ask. You don't know unless you put the offer out there.
You take what
that's
you
why
want.
Teams used to always want to play. Players wanted to play for the Raiders back in the day, and we had that legacy. Because they knew Mr. Davis would be
without
interested.
That.
He would bring him out. How do you think we end up with Eric Dickerson? How do you think we end up with Bo Jackson?
Yeah. The Al Davis
you know,
was
taking
that.
These risks.
Al
taking,
Davis
how do we end
mover.
Up with Richard
right.
Seymour? How do we end up with
we
Richard
don't
Seymour?
We have that now.
In the prime of his coming out of New England.
Well, I think in general, as I look at our team right now.
Randy Moss.
I thought about this, especially in his past few losses. If you look at teams that go into the playoffs and win championships, and you look at both sides of the ball, somewhere on that team, there is a future Hall of Famer or a star in the league that's out there making differences in the game and being a game changer. And right now, I don't see any.
Josh Jacobs has
aside
the potential,
from Josh Jacobs
and Max
Darryl
Crosby
Hall.
Has the potential to be a Hall of Fame player. But Josh Jacobs has the potential to be a Hall of Fame
but that's
player.
Potential. No, I'm sorry. I'll rephrase that. You usually see guys on the field that are actually, you know, they're going to the Hall of Fame. You know what I mean?
Right.
Real players
right.
that have
right.
long story
right.
careers that got them there.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Sure, we got all the potential.
But
the
we've
world.
Got to create those players now. That's where we are. New campus in Vegas. You know, Gruden only in his third year of a 10-year contract. And us leaving a lot of baggage back in Oakland and truly having a lot of new rebuilt pieces that are going to have to be the new we have to create. God damn it, Stone. Fuck. We have to create our own Hall of Famers.
You take
we did it with Jim
want.
Otto. We did it with Billy Cannon.
Yeah.
We did it with Clem Daniels. We did it with Ewart Dixon. These were all Raiders that came in. Tom Flores. You know, these were guys that had to be molded into being. Charles Woodson. They had to be molded into being Hall of Famers. Okay? And we have to create that. We have to do it. That's doing the fucking work. Giving
yes.
this cocksucker $100 million.
Right.
He needs to be churning out Hall of
yes,
Famers. He
dude.
Needs to be coaching Hall of Famers. He needs to be creating them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what he gets paid to do.
Right. And but see that the difference is, you know, you go to the game and you fake light a torch that's, you know, a fake torch. The torch is right here, dude. You could turn on the light. That's what it is. It's that youthful mentality of, oh, we've got all this money. It's a rich kid mentality. You're all sitting fat. You know, you're paid and you're relaxed. You're comfortable.
Too relaxed.
You're really too comfortable to have made a call like that, knowing the history of this organization, knowing this man behind us. This is no, like I've said, show whatever. This is no joke. Al Davis football. This is Al Davis's team. We don't have his leadership anymore. And look at what's happened after 9 years. And then the 4 years before that where he wasn't at his best
health-wise. His leadership lives in me.
You know, yes, it lives in
us. I'm going to fuck around, and I'm going to do something criminal to get me about $800 million so I can buy this fucking team, and you'll see us back on top.
Man.
On some real shit.
It's like, if you're not going to do what you know, right by that name.
Because I've called more right than I've called wrong.
Yes.
And we can start with you being here.
Right. Right.
Being here. Called it. We were a part of it. Since a lot of you motherfuckers don't know. But we ain't gonna go too deep in that. Because I know you're out there thinking, you motherfuckers think y'all just a part of everything. And we are, motherfucker.
That'll be show
20. We are.
Show 20. Right,
we have pioneered a lot 20. Of shit and influenced a lot of shit. I ain't whistling Dixie around this motherfucker. Okay? And proof right. of all of that That's is real. Out there and coming. Well, I'm not gonna compromise anything for you motherfuckers. There's no apologies. There's no excuses.
No excuses.
Okay? And I know just as much. And he knows just as much. And she knows just as much. This fucking organization than the more L.A. phonies that are running it right now.
Mm-hmm.
No offense, Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm. Those of you that are real down there.
Those of you that know what the fuck we're really talking about.
We've gone back.
You really know your Raider football. And your Raider, again, business. A professional football and yes. the business of the Oakland Raiders.
Yes.
We're being ran by a bunch of fucking Los Angeles snobs who don't know what the fuck they're doing. Mm-hmm. And that's why Chucky had that hat on. Like Stone said, it was no fucking accident.
That's right.
He hears right. us. But he that was a message. To, and I hear person. You too, dude. But you have got to put up or get the fuck out too.
Yeah.
Because we're not playing no more. I'm going to keep the legacy of Al yeah, Davis alive. Team. And Al Davis traded Ken Stabler. And he traded Jack Tatum. And he moved franchise.
He traded John Gruden.
Right.
He traded John Gruden. Okay.
Right.
You feel me?
Because you
need to have that type of larceny in your heart.
I was very
heart.
Sad that day. Just for
I
the
was
record.
Very sad too. You know? But that's the attitude I'm talking about.
It's like you ate all you know? That. You
especially
know?
Here in Vegas, baby.
You didn't invent anything new.
All
this
in.
Is, this is like just do
all
what,
in.
Do what we say.
All in on changing the culture to being dominant, to being winning. Okay. And
yeah,
to being non-apologetic about doing it.
Yeah.
And fun. Let's have some fucking fun, man. This is Vegas.
Right.
That's what we all came here
shit,
for.
Right. Touchdowns, not field goals.
Pussy-ass second down run traps
well,
and shit.
When the anyway. Raiders when the Raiders have success in Vegas, it will be the biggest party on the face of the planet. We're just anxious to get it.
Don't you want
sooner
that?
Sooner than later.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
I'm ready for it, man.
Yeah, we're
that's
ready
why I came
for
here.
It. Yeah. Exactly.
Anyway, Stone, you want to ring us around the NFL? What the fuck is going on
yeah.
here? Well, my boy Josh Allen from up the road in Wyoming, who I've been watching since he was playing for Wyoming, is out there killing it, killing it, killing it.
I
got to
admit, man,
about.
I am
okay.
I'm rooting for the Bills right
man,
now.
Man, me too. I'm rooting
yeah,
for the
yeah.
Chiefs.
I've always made
fuck
I,
the Chiefs.
I've always had the joke, what do the Buffalo Bills and marijuana have in common? And they both get smoked in bowls.
Oh,
I've been saying that for years. And then all of a sudden now this year, I think that the Buffalo Bills might shut me up. I mean, they're right now playing, as
yeah,
far as
this,
I'm concerned,
this is it.
Sure, there's a lot of great teams right now in the playoff hunt. The Steelers are a great team. The Packers on the AFC, of course, you got the Kansas City Chiefs. Tennessee Titans look like they could be formidable on any given day. But the Buffalo Bills have, first of all, with the young quarterback who you've been touting, and I'm completely on board now with, and now going, wow, this is a big, strong kid that knows what he's doing and playing real football. He's very aggressive, he's very confident, and he's dominating the field at such an early part of his career. Mm. It's amazing. But the Buffalo Bills have shown over the past few years with their draft picks, they've been doing the right things. They've been getting a couple guys that I've wanted. Star Lutelele, you know, some of the defensive
yeah.
tackle. They're getting guys on their defensive special teams, and they built a team where all they needed was a quarterback
right on.
To wrap
so
it up and go
it.
And win a championship.
That's the league exactly. these
and
days.
Now they're doing
and that's
it.
Where we're sitting.
That's the league.
That's where we're sitting when you look at a Henry Ruggs and you
that's
look
right.
at an Aguilar.
But we don't got that defense.
Of Henry
we
Ruggs.
Don't
gotta get
strong. You're going to get your defense, brother. You're going to get your defense. Oh, trust God. Me. But yeah, I just want to say hello to Buffalo Jan. Out here in Las Vegas. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's
yeah.
up, Jan?
Yes, and her man, Mark, not Mark, Tom?
No.
What are you talking about?
Bob?
Rich.
Rich.
Rich?
Jan and Rich, Buffalo Jan and Rich, who are here in Vegas, friends of ours. Well, friends themselves, really. But I know them too. I've met them a couple of times. Great people. Watched the game with them a couple years ago. But they're here in Vegas, and they're Buffalo. One of the few Buffalo Bills fans that are here in the desert. And, of course, we'd meet them. And they're cool. They're cool.
Well, so if they're congratulations in Vegas, you're going to beat them.
They're diehard. They're diehard Buffalo Bills fans. And I know she's very happy. Yeah, she's got her whole house decorated in Buffalo Bills stuff.
She's
got
a Bills handbag, a Bills, dog. Yeah.
She's like us about it with the Bills.
His own jersey. Yeah. Your dogs have their own jerseys. It's like, it's off the hook.
Yeah, it is.
Well, that's what you got to love about Bills fans. They're a hardcore. To live in that part of the country.
Right.
Man, to freeze your ass off and watch games in that weather year after year after year. You got to be hardcore.
Some of them with no shirts on and all that type of
they
shit.
They peed themselves.
Shorts on, yeah. But yeah, that's going down. I also want to say to another quarterback that, you know, fuck Stephen A. Smith and, you know, some of these cats on these TV shows, the Rex Ryans and the Dan Orlowskis. And, you know, all of y'all jumping on Justin Herbert's jock. I was the first one really telling motherfuckers that this kid was going to kill.
Raider
the first
Raider
time
exclusive.
He got in the game, all right, and started his career with the Chargers, you know, 10 weeks ago. All right, and he proved me right. Okay, I told you this was an up-and-comer. I told you he was a killer, and I just want to say congratulations to him, even though he's a fucking Charger. Okay, you know, I saw his work. I saw him in Oregon, and I knew he was coming not to fuck around in the NFL, and he's proved me right.
Nothing worse seeing great players in college that you know are going to be great in the NFL.
Just like you saw with Ben Roethlisberger.
The other team.
Just like you saw with Ben Roethlisberger. Congratulations to you, Justin, setting the NFL rookie passing TD record with 28 touchdowns this season. So right on to you, man, for coming in and getting busy and doing what our 7-year veteran can't even come fucking close to. Anyway.
I thought that this last game, and I still think, that Derek Carr, after the pulled nut muscle, to come in and make a lot of the plays he does. I think he has a great chemistry with Darren Waller. I think he understands the offense.
Waller should be comped on the strip for the rest of the year. Okay? Straight up. He's
Darren
the next
the
big star in Los Angeles.
But Derek Carr did make some. And he's done it all year. To me, the 0-10 in the red zone, I'm sorry, 0-10 on third down conversions, that's a horrible, dismal thing to consider. But he made a lot of long passes. One of them down the middle to Henry Ruggs. I wish Henry Ruggs could at least cut a guy.
I made a lot of long passes, you know, too, from across a
that
long
that last pass he made to Nelson Aguilar to potentially win the game at the end of the night, to me, was impressive. And to come back after an injury, to me, at least showed some heart and that he wanted to play and go out there and win. And he's not Justin Herbert. He's not any of these other guys you're talking about. He's no Josh Allen.
Yeah, but that's where the fucking league's going,
Stone.
But
he makes
Stone.
Plays.
Oh, my God. He I makes can plays. Make a play. It'll be quick. Because I don't want to get out. Got to get out of the way of them trains. But come on. You can make a play. I'm paying you $8 million, dude. You need to make more than just plays. You need to get in the red zone and score, but you're afraid every time. All you Carr fans, look at what happens when we get to the red zone. How many times have we not converted on third down? We cannot ever get to a championship. Yes, our defense can win, but damn, our quarterback can't be giving up the ball. Can't turn it over. Has to score. Stop being afraid. Like the backup that came in, he wasn't scared. He did that. I could see the speed of the offense and what it was meant to do when I saw him.
Marcus Mariota.
Yeah, it was with Mariota. But here I am with Carr back again this week. You know, and he's doing the same thing. It's the same thing. It's been 7 years. When are you going to get to the playoffs? Look at what happened. 5 games down. Dude, you just lost ones that you should have won. And it would have made the difference had the leadership been smart enough to figure out how to connect with his receivers and win those
I'm
games.
Just happy that Derek Waller outsold him in Christmas sales.
Derek, we love you, Derek Waller.
Don't nobody want no fucking number 4 jersey. But anyway, y'all continue on with your Jim Jones in
here. Yeah, I think we got
Derek Carr.
I think I'm done
Jim Jones in for a minute.
I did see number 82 on the field more this game. You know, I really
wanted you've been calling for Jason Witten.
Jason
Witten
was
out there.
Get on the field in this game. He was out there, but look.
He got overthrown a number of times, too.
Yeah,
he did. Whatever, man. You know, I hear it. And God
bless. He could have scored the touchdown.
I left Oakland in 2014 for this exact reason. So I ain't tripping. I can always go back to what I was doing before I came back to watch this bullshit again and talk about it. You know, so I ain't worried about it. They got maybe 2-3 more years with me, and wherever Trevor Lawrence goes, that'll be the jersey I'm wearing. You know, because I'm not about to grow old with this bullshit and be out there like some of my old
trying
chums.
To get you to see.
You know, that were 70 and 80 10 years ago. In my ear, talking about, God damn it, this motherfucker. You know, I ain't growing old like that. You know, I came here to have fun, man.
Well, basically for me to kind of just even wrap up the whole, all the ideas that you threw out there, with me, I agree 100% with the vision. Being able to have that kind of vision going into this offseason and be able to see bigger than you can even imagine now of where it could be and where you want it to be and try to get there, as opposed to just focusing on what we have right now, because what we have right now hasn't been enough to even we're talking the years, like you said, years and years and years of the same pretty much records, the same type of play, the same breakdowns in the end
December,
of the year.
Downhill,
Downhill
December.
Drastic yes. measures call for drastic action.
Yes.
I know, Stone.
Our dedication tonight, as we always do, D-E-A-D-I. Dedication. And of
dedication.
Course, if you have any dedications that you'd like us to read sometime here on the show, you can hit us down below here where we like and subscribe and share, but in our comments section. We have no problem doing that. RaiderFanRadio@gmail.com. We know that, you know, a lot of Raider fans out there, have people that are very special in their lives that they want to remember, and we'd love to remember them with you if the situation allows.
RaiderFanRadio@gmail.com.
Our dedication goes to a great pioneer of the genre of hip-hop music, a man who is a part of our generation, Generation X, you know, and he was someone who became one of the first truly supreme MCs and live performers in hip-hop, as well as a great lyricist and a great personality in hip-hop, a pioneering rapper from New York City, Brooklyn, New York, to be exact. John Fletcher, better known as Ecstasy of the group Whodini, died last week at the age of 56, and someone that is just very dear to my heart.
Yes.
And I know Steph's heart. And
I'll be honest. I'm not very familiar.
That we're at the beginnings and origins of hip hop.
I'm not very familiar. So give me just a little bit of the background as far as like where do you originally come? I know he comes from New York. But what was his getting into hip-hop to become an artist?
Well, as you know, hip-hop, you know, spawned from New York. And he started out as just a kid, like most of the kids who from that generation that were grasping on to the Cool Herc, who was a famous DJ in New York, and DJ Red.
What years?
We're talking 78, 79,
damn,
80.
Okay, we're talking
late 70s.
All
yeah,
40 90s. Years ago.
Yes, with the hip hop as we know it today, its origins. And just a kid that was in a crew. Back then you had crews, you know.
Crews?
Yeah, rap crews, dance
crews. Okay, I played in a bunch of bands.
Same thing.
What's a crew?
Well, a crew was when hip hop first started, you had three dynamics.
It's like Hip Hop 101.
Okay.
I'm learning right now.
You had a DJ who would be the one to spin
that
the record.
You'd
see an instrumental of a record. And then you had the MC, later to be known as the rapper. Okay, and he's the one that would MC the show.
Or she's
rap.
The one.
Or she, yes.
Or she, there's she. Girls, female
yes.
rappers
yes.
too?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And then you had your
rap
dance
stars.
Crew.
They call them rap stars.
And then you had your dance crew. Because then at the start of hip hop, was breakdancing was emerging. So you had pop locking fusing
so
into.
So that's the. Wait, now that's the formation of the band. I got
that's
my DJ.
The core.
Right.
I got my MC rapper.
Right. And you got your dance.
And I got my dance crew working
you got your
up
dance
front.
Crew. And that would be your crew.
Gotcha.
And then a group could be one MC or could be two MCs. And so you had Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, which was five MCs. So anyway, that's where
that's
he started.
That's a plethora of MCs.
And they would battle each other around the cities. And so in Brooklyn.
Battle.
Started, yeah, battle
like,
rap.
Like, could you rap like. You
like
know,
battle the band.
You got to have a flow that
okay.
Not.
You know, I like that.
I hear that you're a great
I like
rapper.
The competition that.
You're right. MC Stoner right. dude. You're MC Stoner dude. And I'm, you know, rapping Rob. And we know each other.
Right.
You feel me? You're from across
the world. But I'm trying to kick your ass
you
out there when we go rap together.
Me and you running each other in the park, or people set it up in the park, where me and you battle.
Wait, that's not what I was looking for.
Then me and you. Then we,
my bad.
That eventually
happens. That happens you start, in the park.
That eventually happens.
Happens in
try to
life.
Out-rap me,
right?
Motherfucker.
Well, that eventually did happen.
Yes, it got worse than you would know.
But sorry, anyway, I just watched Straight Outta Compton the other night. You know, I love that.
Oh god,
that's like one of the that's like probably the one rap album I've always liked is N.W.A. But
right
I'm
on.
Sorry,
okay.
Back to your boy.
Right on. So he was in a crew.
Interesting.
And he,
I didn't know that.
He heard about another guy who was in a crew, and that
Rebellious.
Would end up being his partner, who is Jahlil Hutchins, who was better known as MC Jahlil. Okay, and they ended up forming a group together. And it was just at first supposed to be a lark. They were doing
a lark because that was how that rappers talk. Would this be a lark?
Would this be a new slapper? There was a famous DJ, Mr. Magic, in New York, and he had heard about both of them, and so he put them together to come down and put a rap song together. And he was taking different people's songs, and he was going to play them on the air, but it was all supposed to be centered around him. This DJ, he was getting promos.
Yeah,
you know?
I remember him.
And that was how he started. Him and Jahlil ended up getting close. They made the song. Their song was the one that got the spins and won the contest. And from there, Whodini was born. Now, Whodini signed with Jive Records, which was a London label. So all their records were recorded in London. London is where they broke first. England.
Dang, like Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah. That's where they broke first.
Is that kind of ironic sometimes? Some American artists need to go to other countries to go break
right.
it,
to be
make
free.
It.
Right.
That, yeah, to be free.
Well, the other dynamic to that was that they were managed by Russell Simmons, who was also noted as one of the great pioneers, along with Rick Rubin, of hip hop in New York back then. And they were a duo that ran Rush Management and managed Run DMC, of course.
Yeah.
Well,
that
was,
I knew.
Yeah. Russell
That's
Simmons
it.
Managed Whodini, but apparently, as the story goes, he thought they were too slick and too smooth because they had a whole style that was about leather.
Mm-hmm.
He made the Zorro hat
leather
popular.
Leather jackets with no shirts.
Yeah, Ecstasy made the Zorro hat popular. That was his trademark, the Zorro hat. They were slick dressed with suits and, you know, really upscale type rappers, but diverse. Anyway, they broke in London and they were signed to Jive Records, and that was where they got their first fame. And then they came to America and hit. And were the one of the headliners of one of the first big hip-hop tours, which was called the Squatch Watch Fresh Festival, which I attended at the Oakland Coliseum, and we'll probably pop a poster up here. But yeah, you know, and from there they went on to have success. They had such hits as, they had a great song for Halloween. Next Halloween, for all you kids, you want a nice song, or you young folks that don't know anything about Whodini, check out Haunted House of Rap.
Yes, that's the bomb.
That was
that's
one of their first
the
hits. Yeah.
Yep.
And I'm going to turn this over to Steph for a minute because, like I said, Ecstasy and Whodini and them were sex symbols and Jahlil. And then you had Friends. How many of us have them? Friends.
Ba-boom, ba-boom.
The ones we can depend on.
Let's be friends.
Then they had 5 minutes of funk. They had Funky Beat.
Mm-hmm.
They had their most famous hit, Freaks Come Out at Night,
mm-hmm.
Which was a lot of live shots taken from that tour, the Fresh Fest in 84. But the main bulk of that video was filmed at the Oakland Coliseum, particularly the beginning when they get off the tour buses and are singing Friends at the beginning, a cappella. They're underneath the arena and the stadium, the parking underneath the Coliseum arena and stadium. And young Jermaine Dupri from So So Def and the producer of many hits from the South Sound, of hip-hop and R&B, was a young dancer for them at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And another group, UTFO, with the Kango Kid and Dr. Ice. Anyway, long story short...
How did he die?
That has not been disclosed.
Same thing with Kevin
that has
Green.
Not been
I don't know what happened.
But we dedicate tonight's show to John Ecstasy Fletcher of Whodini. And Steph, again, he was one of the first, like, you know...
One of the first, like...
Guys that the ladies was into in hip-hop.
Right. Rap sex symbol. You know, these
Did
were
Did you lust
sex.
After him?
He was definitely on the list of lusters. Or lusties.
Your lust list.
But I was definitely a Whodini fan. And I was going to any show that they had. And I was just coming up. So, you know, a lot of these hits and everything were coming out. age 15, 16, 17.
Right.
These were times where, you know, like, we were on lockdown. I couldn't go out. But by the time 16 hit, in Oakland especially, being the center, concert center, and having, you know, some of the best shows happen in the Coliseum or in the stadium, they were definitely one of them. They always put on a great, great show. And Rob was actually was in negotiations to bring Whodini to the Black Hole to perform. Mm-hmm. And we just couldn't get it done at the time, but that would have been phenomenal.
Yeah.
They were just the ones that, you know, you bought the Ride On magazine for. You know, you got to look up and see what they're doing next. And, you know,
Ride On magazine.
Right. It was like, we always were like, those are cute rappers. They're actually cute. You know?
Slut.
It did. You know,
you bring up the Oakland Coliseum. There's a recent as it just came out like a week or two ago. A documentary on the Bee Gees.
And it's called
How Can You Mend a Broken Heart? I've seen it at least probably three times at this point, just because when it comes to music history, I'm a documentarian and I love history, but also I remember those days.
Right.
Yeah, and, that's our generation.
The beginning of the documentary opens up at the Oakland Coliseum. I mean, I wasn't living in the Bay, but I know you two were, so I'm imagining you guys. Either
I wasn't there,
either then or anywhere around there, at least. Or
we were all doing it.
Or more to the point, just knew what Oakland was like at the in 1979 and 78.
I remember that sign.
Thinking about the history,
the Bee Gees sign. Sorry, Stone. I remember when they were coming.
That's what I meant. There you go. You actually remember the moment.
I was conscious of, like, oh my God, there's the Bee Gees are coming. You know, I was just. 10 years old, once again, something about that. The Bee Gees.
As far as the documentary goes, my dad, a stoner dad, who I bring up a lot on the show, is my biggest musical influence because he gave me all the music. Prior to those disco days that you're talking about, the Bee Gees were three brothers who literally sang and played together from childhood.
Yeah.
And so by the time they got to that point, what you're talking about, they had this whole history, 20-30 year history,
right,
storyline that
they had broken up. They had broken up and all that. Yeah,
difference. Their music, of course, changed with the 60s and into the 70s, and it was because of that falsetto voice that Barry Gibb had. That's what created
their harmony,
disco sound.
Their harmony.
Yeah, it was amazing.
And they had some of the best fucking hooks.
It's a great, great documentary if you get a chance to see it. If you love music and you learn about a band that you probably didn't know information about.
Yeah, but that had so much influence even on music today. You know, just in writing, a lot of.
And they were a mainstay, of course. Their music of disco and Studio 54, that whole legend and legacy. Go back and check that out, of that era of the mid and late 70s and early 80s. And then, of course, Saturday Night Fever, one of the most popular and greatest all-time selling movies in history with John Travolta. You know, and so they were very big. They were like the Beatles, you know, as people say, and the Jacksons and all that. Just a big group, man, that sold well.
That's a great way. I like the way you just put it, though. When you compare,
very popular.
They do have that type of iconic history. History that's real, you know.
Yeah.
They really stood the test of time.
Yeah, they did. They did. So, during that time, we lost another person who was very prominent at that time, and they probably wore some of his clothing. I know I did. Pierre Cardin, the great French fashion designer. Pierre Cardin. Those of you who are Generation X and grew up in the 80s. What did he make? He made clothing.
He made
sweatsuits. I had a few of his sweatsuits growing up, and they were the most comfortable sweatsuits, man. The velvet and the velour that he made.
Sweatsuits. I still need to get my first sweatsuit.
What? Yeah, man. Oh, my God.
If you haven't got one by now, it ain't happening.
No, it's never too late to have a sweatsuit. And get on a tennis racket or something.
He
had a... Oh, good.
I had the little tennis shoes,
the Pierre Cardin tennis shoes were popular.
PC, you know, with the circle.
Yep.
Those were really
And the cologne, his Pierre Cardin cologne, too, was very popular. But he also was a mainstay of Studio 54 during the days of disco and all that. He would party in there with Karl Lagerfeld and some of the other great designers of the day. But, yes, he was, you know, just
He's dead now, too?
A great icon of the 80s, and the 90s. Pierre Cardin did it in 98. So,
anyway. 98?
Rocked it, baby. Yeah. 98. Damn. Oh, man. I'm trying to get to 103. So
Pierre Cardin was a player and a player.
Trying to get to 54. Man. Speaking of 54. I'm trying to get to age 54.
Hey, did you guys... A couple weeks ago, see this kid in Texas by any chance? You bum. Doug Brooks down in Shiner, Texas.
Is it Derek or Doug?
Doug. His name is Doug Brooks. He is a junior in high school. And if you have not seen him, go right now while you're looking at us and search, okay, Doug Brooks, Shiner High School, Texas. This kid. Is 6'2", 270 pounds.
What?
And
he's
the
alive?
Damage that he did
running
to this team a couple of weeks ago in Texas Texas playoffs was amazing. And the video is up there. Check it out. But wow.
I saw the video.
I showed you.
You
the
showed
video.
It to me.
Good God,
and
I'm, man.
Like you said, everybody here right now, listen, we'll go check him out too. Yeah, he looks like, you remember those old cartoons of Baby Huey? Like, Baby Huey was this big, giant cartoon character. I forgot what he was, a bird or something.
He was a duck.
And all his, friends were just, you know, regular-sized people.
Yeah,
right. All the bullies were just small, regular-sized people. But Baby Huey's this big, giant, and he doesn't even know how big he is.
Right,
he's
he doesn't know
big
his own
dope.
Strength. He doesn't know his
and
own strength.
And then he rolls over everybody like a bowling ball.
Yeah.
Like they don't even exist.
Yeah.
That's what this kid reminded me of. He's just going through a football team like a knife through hot knife through butter. Just, yeah, knocking people over like a bowling ball. They're just little pins flying to the side.
And what wasn't shown in that video when you folks watched the full video, he also had a block. Okay, and returned it for a touchdown, the fumble. Then there was another fumble.
He's fast.
He scooped that
up.
He's
not Baby Huey. He's an athlete.
Yeah, running down the field alongside his teammate. Got to the 2-yard line, flipped it to his teammate, and his teammate scored. Then to get a first down earlier in the game, they had put him under center.
Wow.
And he went on an end around and got the first down.
He's a football player.
He's a monster. It's like watching... You know, I don't know, Reggie White, if you remember Reggie White playing, you know, skill position.
Man,
I mean, you know,
every
it's unfair.
That's the kind of player that the Raiders need on defense, man.
I feel you.
A Reggie White.
Yes.
Someone that's just a... Look, they went out. I'm rolling it back to the Raiders real quick just because I can't help but think when you bring those kind of players.
Yeah.
You know, they went and got Trent Brown because he's so huge and all that, you know, stuff. And he hasn't even really
played
that.
But he's soft as fuck, speaking of Baby
Huey. That's my point.
Oh.
You know, on the defensive side, excuse me, side of the ball, we need a fucking beast in the middle of the line that has that kind of dominating force.
Why
when
not?
They walk in the field... Everybody knows who that dude is,
right.
You know? Watch out for that dude right there. Right to the quarterback.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of getting to the quarterback, for the fourth week in a row, Mr. J.J. Watt has voiced his displeasure with the Houston Texans and the state of
he
his career.
He more than voiced his displeasure. He put on a
I'm
press conference.
I'm glad you
Are
saw
you
it.
Kidding me? I thought of you the whole time.
Come
like, we want J.J.
to
Watt.
Vegas.
You know you're watching
Vegas.
Coach Gruden, you know I love you. Mike Mayock, I love you. We've gotten behind you, and we stay behind you all the way. I mean, we're riding all the way through. So when I say to you, go out and make J.J. Watt happen, that's the kind of guys we're talking about.
We're talking
They're
going
to get us all excited at the beginning of the season to go to games and just to go, whoa, they went for it.
J.J. Watt is fun.
That's a football player.
He's fun and ferocious. Okay, that's what we're talking about.
He changes the heart of the
team. Same way when Alvin got Trace Armstrong and when you got John Perella.
Yep.
That's what we're talking about.
Yep.
Come on, John. You know what we're talking about, man. Stop fucking around.
Right.
You know, and Mayock, you know too. Stop with the bullshit. On another note, Ty Jordan, young man up in Utah, freshman, unfortunately had an accident outside of Dallas, Texas, his home in Denton, Texas, where he accidentally shot himself in the abdomen and died from those wounds. And, you know, yeah, I just want to say, you young people with opportunity, you young people that are in school, you young people that are getting a chance to advance your life, unlike so many others in your peer group and in your community, you've got to take and make better choices and take better stock of the opportunities you've given and the God-given talent you also have, but also the belief and trust that people have in you and you being put in positions of success and to be success and achieve success and guard your life, man, and make smart choices. Stop fucking with these guns, okay, on the real, man. Yeah. You know, indiscriminately and what have you. 19-year-old man who I got a chance to see him play this year with Utah in one of the games in the Mountain West out here. And that's just a sad, sad thing, man. But you youngsters, man, these guns, stop it. Yeah. Stop playing with you, especially when you got regular musician, whatever, aspiring artist, aspiring lawyer. You want to grow up to be a social worker, a nurse, whatever you want to be. In your formative years of understanding this thing we call life, man, stay away from things that can harm you.
Right.
Especially please.
When you're in the position.
You know, because it's just a tragedy. So many young people are losing your lives to accidents like this and just indiscriminate bad choices. So yeah, anyway.
That happens with guns. You know, you have a weapon. You need to, number one, know how to use it. And number two, respect it. You know, and, you know, you don't play around. So many kids have died from Russian roulette or getting a hold of their parents' gun. They didn't have the safety on. You know, there's nothing wrong with that, with your weapons, but you have to be responsible. And even if you are responsible, you're still standing the risk of having something like that happen to somebody close to wherever your gun is. Yeah. So, you know, think about that.
It's real talk. Stone, any comment on guns?
No. I think you said it all actually perfectly.
Yeah. Hey, let me ask you something. You guys like burgers?
I love burgers.
Yeah. You love burgers?
Yeah.
I love burgers.
You love burgers. You love burgers.
I love burgers.
Would you eat a burger with gold on it?
No.
No, I want the gold.
Yeah. I'd take the gold and go buy more burgers.
Right.
Okay. Would you go to Columbia to get it?
No, I go
down the street. Barcode Burger right here on Flamingo.
They don't have any gold. They don't have 24 gold plated. A restaurant in Columbia.
What are you talking about?
Is selling gold 24 karat gold plated hamburgers.
What do you mean? They put gold in the burger?
They put gold.
They eat it?
Around
they eat it?
The burger, yes.
No.
Yes.
That's a waste.
It's gold.
It's a waste.
Oh, right.
Gold. 24 karat gold.
Wait, leaf. Where is this?
This is down in Bogota, Colombia.
They got a lot of gold to just throw away like that and put it on their hamburger.
Well, you know that they're rich. The Coke industry was good to them.
I guess so.
Back in the 80s and early 90s. You know, Colombia, that's home of the Medellin and the Cali cartels, maybe two of the biggest cartels in the world. You know?
Oh my gosh, but you are wasting good gold.
Wasting good beef.
Yeah, well, both. I mean, it's like.
It better be good beef with all that gold. Yeah. Is it like Kobe beef? Or Kobe beef?
Kobe or Wagyu.
I got one for that. I got one for that Kobe. But I just.
Don't
too
do
soon.
Don't
come on.
It's too soon.
Don't leave me hanging.
It's too soon. Yeah. No.
Interesting. No thanks. I would.
I'm just going to say don't let your Kobe be flying a helicopter. But anyway.
Wait. Where's the fucking.
Which one do you want this one? Or you want.
Wait.
Yeah, gold plated burgers, man.
That's the one I want.
Gold 24 karat gold burgers. Okay?
No, thank you. I want the gold and I want the burgers separate because what happens with the stuff that you eat? I mean, why would you process gold and not use it for dough?
There's a place in Vegas called Fuck You Burger.
Yep.
It's Fuku.
I love that.
I think that's they creative. Pronounce it Fuku.
Yeah.
But when you're driving down the road,
it looks like
you see it there. It says Fuck You Burger. It sure big does. And lights.
Yeah. It's beautiful.
Food. That's I the kind of burger.
Have
I
you
like.
Been there yet?
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Was it good?
Fuck you. I have. We got to get them as a sponsor.
Okay.
We got to go walk in there and get Fuck You Burger as a sponsor.
Right. Yeah, we got to work on that.
I might just start sponsoring them anyways.
Yeah, we got to work on that. We got to work. Now, staying in the food topical conversation here, you, myself, Steph here, Stone, and what? I want to let all of you know.
You better let me know before you include me.
One of the best, if not best, female video gamers and Madden players you'll ever meet.
Oh.
Okay, so any of you chicks down there that watch us, if you think you can go toe-to-toe
Madden cat
okay,
fights
with Steph to play Madden, I'm putting up 50. I'm putting like up 50 that. On
Gamers
Steph.
Holiday. Because,
yeah, you know, some of y'all come.
We'll
to
do a tournament. Yeah, oh, wait, we'll you throw tournament. Down the gauntlet?
Yes. Yeah.
Why not?
We got to get back to that. Yeah. Anyway, we are professional Madden players.
I love
We've been
Madden.
Playing Madden for years. We used to get together and play and go at it for hours and hours and hours.
I know, well, like weekends.
Yes, weekends. Now, playing Madden.
Super okay. Bowls, tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
Playing Madden on the console, okay? All right, now I'm going to ask you. Chicken. You don't eat chicken much anymore, I don't think, right?
No, I don't eat
but
chicken.
But you still eat chicken. I love chicken.
I love chicken. I eat
okay,
chicken.
Fried chicken.
They
now,
eat chicken.
What would you...
Barbecue
would,
chicken, fried chicken, chicken teriyaki.
What would you say chicken, if chicken. I could give you and produce for you a gaming console for us to play Madden,
mm-hmm.
and then there's a little oven warmer in there, and we could put chicken...
In the game?
Or any kind of food inside the warmer.
You mean cook while you're playing?
Cook? No, you're cooking, you're warming, but your food is eating, and you can sit there and pull out a moonwing and hit you a moonwing and drumstick or something. You know, you might want a fried bologna sandwich in there to keep warm or grilled cheese or whatever. KFC has come out with the KF console.
What?
No.
Yes.
No, no this I never no. heard of. This I don't know
KFC,
nothing of.
Okay, your friendly neighborhood chicken spot. Mm, okay, that used to be Kentucky Fried Chicken when we were growing
different,
up.
Different.
Until they went and got them steroided Arnold Schwarzenegger ass birds. Okay, and then they changed it to KFC. Okay.
Do you want the breast or a thigh?
I want the thigh.
You want one of my four legs?
Please pump me up. I want some coleslaw. Best coleslaw in the world. They are getting into the gaming.
They're really going to make a video game.
They've already made
only
it. No, they're not making
run.
A video game. They're making
a console.
A PS5
like you can buy an Xbox
compatible console.
KFC.
KFC console that comes with an oven warmer. It's like the old combination of the Betty Crocker.
The Betty
oven.
Crocker.
Easy
Bake
Oven.
Easy
Bake
Oven.
Easy
Bake
Oven.
Right. Yeah,
or remember when TVs came out and they had the fucking VHS attachment, the first TVs
yeah,
that were combo.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
combo.
The CD player. With the TV,
right,
all that old type
right,
of
right,
shit.
Right.
You can, well, you can warm up food while you're playing up. A game. Nope. I like the idea. Here's why. I'm a stoner.
You love food, number
I'm
one.
I'm a stoner. I like convenience.
Yes.
I like the idea of being able to play my Madden. Can I play Madden?
Yes.
Okay, I can play Madden.
Madden, Call of Duty, Fortnite, all that shit.
And I can end up, I always got the munchies.
Right.
So I think this is pretty much tailor made for me.
It's cool as fuck.
I got my food
it's
right there.
Yeah.
I got my wings. I got my yeah. whatever I want to eat up. Anything.
Exactly.
I
yeah.
can eat up.
It doesn't
a little,
necessarily have to be
muffin.
Chicken or anything like that.
Yeah, it can be whatever you want.
That's hella lazy. That's why
you
I
can have some. You can yeah. have a couple of slices of gluten free pizza in there.
I would.
Yeah.
Have no way.
Gluten free. Come on, gluten free.
But imagine how greasy the console is.
Right there.
I know.
You know,
doesn't it got like a self-cleaning thing? Or
might as well.
Yeah, it's got
in there somewhere.
It's in there
right?
somewhere. Yeah. But I'm talking about those of you that are playing it. You out there playing it, you're going to get the damn things all greasy.
Yeah,
right.
But it means
greasy.
I don't have to get up yeah. and go to the kitchen.
Yeah.
I like it all right
see,
there.
It'll
it.
All be
you
right there. You got
get
your weed,
don't
yeah.
do
you got
it,
your
folks.
Food.
I got my bong, I got my console, I got my gig, I got my thumbs going at it like that, and I got my food.
Yep.
Sold. You know what to get me for Christmas next year.
It's in the fast lane.
Hey, you, hey, KFC, I'm calling you out. You
yeah,
guys,
we gotta get KFC.
I'm calling KFC corporate.
I'm
calling KFC corporate office right now. Stoner dude, you need to get him in a commercial.
He
y'all,
likes it.
Y'all ain't done a commercial yet. Y'all ain't done a commercial yet for your new console.
I can film all day long, just hang out.
Y'all need to put Stone in your commercial.
Let's make it so.
But that's what's up with that, though. That's what's up with that, though.
Man, speaking of Stone, I just had something in that.
Uh-oh.
I saw it. I thought of you. We were talking about waiting in line. What would you wait 14
hours
for?
What would we wait 14 hours in line for?
Right.
Right. And you said Selma Hayek. Real quick, like.
Yeah, yeah, I was right there. I know exactly what I want.
Something happened to Selma.
No, actually.
What'd you do?
I wondered if. Right. I wondered if Stone. The thing is, nothing, but it's actually entertainment news.
She ain't met Stone yet.
Right.
She'll be up to something when she meets him.
Selma Hayek, 54 years old.
54, there's that number
there's
again.
There's the number.
She wears it very well. You
yes,
know what I'm talking
does.
About.
Mm-hmm. She poses in purple bikini as she closes out 20. This is news. As she closes out
2020. This is big news to me.
She shared.
You're getting this on the screen, nice and big, right?
She shared a virtual postcard with nearly 17 million of her Instagram followers.
Damn, she got 17 million followers?
Damn, bitch, you could start a cult. The Selma Hayek Freedom Cult.
I would be a high priest.
You're good.
I'd be not the highest of all priests.
17 million motherfuckers?
And she filmed it from an incredible but undisclosed beach location.
Nice. Clandestine.
Stone likes to chase.
Yeah. I mean, not a movie, but a bikini.
If I, as long as this somehow gets to Selma Hayek's computer, we all did the right thing.
Somebody share this with Selma Hayek on Instagram.
Yes, no, sure. Speaking of Instagram, if you want to trip out on my art, which I know you do, go to Instagram. All you Selma Hayek fans are making. You got 17 million?
Yeah, 17 million.
I think I got like 17. Anyways, on Instagram, Stoner Dude Art, you can check me out.
You need to do it.
Follow me, maybe I might even follow you back. And that's Instagram.com.
You need to do a portrait of Selma Hayek. You need to do one of your portraits of Selma.
Okay, I want to repaint the moment she comes out of Dusk Till Dawn. This is what I fell in love with.
Go.
I know the moment where I fell in love with Selma Hayek.
There it is.
Dusk Till Dawn, the movie. I think it came out somewhere around 95, right. 94, yeah, 95, good, somewhere around there.
Really good movie.
And there's the scene in the titty twister, the Tijuana bar where all the vampires were living.
Oh.
And Selma Hayek comes out on the stage as... I forgot that. I think Satana or something.
Right,
Satanica.
Right.
The name of the vampire queen.
And
she comes out there and she's got that snake boa wrapped all around her. She does that dance. That's it. Found my true love.
There you go.
At Raider Fan Radio. Anyways, there you go. On that note, we make sure you get that on the screen there too, Steph.
What's that?
You can comment. You can suggestions, ideas.
Yes.
Communicate with us right here. Say anything you got to say. Maybe you never know. Future sponsors, we can pimp your shit at Raider Fan Radio. Contact us at RaiderFanRadio@gmail.com.
Now, the Raiders are playing Denver this week. It'll be the last game of the season, the home season. Here in Las Vegas is over. And what do you guys think for the most part? Was it successful?
The season?
The season.
I
here?
Mean, you know, not so much the big debut and rollout, but what, you know, what do you think of the Raiders' first year in?
It wasn't
Vegas?
Successful. You had COVID, you know, the draft was the beginning of it. It was supposed to be our big, you know, splash.
Yeah, we lost that right out of the gate.
Right out the gate. So. You know, and then again, still repeating the same patterns.
No training camp, no. I mean, look, I have as far as the draft class goes, we've been talking about last year how great it was. This year, what has it so far been so great? Certainly not a first year for all these guys, these new young players, you know. I have to put it this way, though, too, you know. I know that a lot of other teams are dealing with COVID, and it shouldn't be an excuse. But it certainly has shaped and molded the way, not only the Raiders, but we've all had to conduct ourselves this year. We've all had to live in the moment, figure out what to do next, because this is all new and it's all hard. It's difficult to deal with. But we got to deal with it. We got to deal with it. We got to go through it. We got to get through it, one way or the other.
Right.
Well, I thought it was great in the sense that they did make it to Las Vegas. A new stadium did open. So the Raiders, after 50 years... bitching and whining and also legitimately calling for a new stadium and all the politics that surrounded it in Oakland and Los Angeles and what have you. That was an achievement. To see the Raiders, for now, have a permanent home, a place to call home, a new facility that it now puts them, as we were criticized for many years of not being in the future of the NFL, has catapulted them into the future of the NFL. There are going to be a lot of Super Bowls here in the future. It'd be nice to be one of the teams in them. And I also think...
Raider home game at the Super Bowl.
Yeah, I also...
That would make up for everything.
Right.
I also want to commend the Las Vegas Raider fans. Those of you that I've met throughout the year and since I've been here. And those of you that were really... hype about the team coming. All of you that turned out at the opening of that Raider image when it did and almost bought it out. There is a fan base here. And I meet you folks from North Vegas and out at Broadacres and up in Summerlin, and we run into each other. And you all are pretty optimistic. And that's what you have to understand over there, 1475. There is a fan base here to be had. And they're looking forward to seeing success. They want the team here, and they want to see the team win. You know, there isn't any hard feelings about how the stadium got built so far. There isn't any public resentment towards the Raiders so far in mass numbers. The watch parties downtown on Fremont Street have been successful, great successes pre-COVID, and the casinos filled with Raider fans in anticipation of this year. So we get back on the 1-21. And, you know, you guys got to grab a hold of this community because they're ready to win. And they're ready to be behind the silver and black. So I think that was two of the successful things that did come out of, like you said, a real hard year to adjust to with COVID. The stadium's open. The Raiders have a new home. And they've got a new fan base that's ready to embrace
them. The stage is set. Straight up.
Welcome to the nation.
Well, that was show number 13. We did it. We got this far. We'll see you at show number 14. Something always to think about. Obviously, not only contact us here, but we are going to be taking more phone calls by some fans here as time goes by. We are going into the off season. The Raider season will end at one point, but Raider Fan Radio will go on through the summer. We'll keep going. We've been doing this now for 18, going on 19 years. And I can tell you this much, as we talk about the successes and the things that we've all done, not just the Raiders, I'm very proud and happy to say we've got this far here in Vegas with the relaunch of Raider Fan Radio.
Congratulations.
Yay, I'll take that as a check mark next to what we got going.
But you all you haters and frauds that didn't think it would last. Just like that.
All right, we'll see you next time. Later, Raider.
Peace out, everyone.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
The views and opinions of RaiderFanRadio.Vegas, RaiderFanRadio.com, and RaiderFan Radio Media are not the views and opinions of the Las Vegas Raiders, Al Davis Football, Inc., or the National Football League. RaiderFanRadio.Vegas is an independent media source.